topic which we are going to cover at this particular point of time is about the surviving malnutrition. So we all know surviving malnutrition in critical illness is very important. So ICU means it's nothing but an organ supporting unit. So when an organ fails in an ICU, we used to support the organs. For an example, if a ventilatory support in a respiratory failure, and if giving an inotropic support in a cardiac failing patient, and renal replacement support in renal failure patients. But in all these supports in intensive care unit, one thing should go in all the organ failures, that is the nutrition support. And if you take the nutrition support, that support should be continued until the primary illness is cured. For example, in congestive cardiac failure, these are the drugs we used to give and we used to have a fluid restriction of them. But in a cerebrovascular accident, these are the drugs we used to give them and give them the adequate hydration. And in a septicemia, the antibiotics, inotropics, and source control and fluid challenge are the routine treatment. But in all these areas of organ failures or the diseases, whatever it may be in an intensive care unit, do we have the nutritional support in the form of kilocalories per day and how many ml has to be given in a day or how many ml in an hour, whether the nutrition should be through the oral route or the rice tube, parenteral or partial parenteral or total parenteral. This is the way we should address the nutritional support in a critically ill patient. Because the need for nutrition is very important. We all understand the medicines is required for the disease, but we used to ask nutrition for what? And when the patient comes with a malnourished state, everybody used to prescribe the nutritional support to them. But we all should remember it is unethical and immoral not to provide nutritional support for the patient with more than 1 week of inadequate intake. So any patient, hospitalized patient, whether they are hospitalized in the critical care units or in the ward, suppose they are not able to take an adequate nutritional support more than a week, it is our moral and ethical responsibility of providing them. This is a nice article came in the year of 2000 itself, showing that the malnutrition in a critically ill patient in the intensive care units are there, and they put it the label as a skeleton in the closet. And if you look into the causes for this particular malnutrition, it is not the patient coming with the malnutrition and getting admitted in the intensive care units. They are becoming malnourished, it's all because of the iatrogenic factors. So we producing the malnutrition on our critically ill patient, and that is why it has to be addressed. If suppose the malnutrition is not addressed properly, what will happen to the malnutrition? For example, a patient having a weight of 100 kilograms, by losing 40 kilograms and coming to the 60 kilogram in the hospital or in the during the illness, these are the things which can happen. Initially, you will have a decreased muscle mass. And because of the decreased muscle mass, you will have a fatigue, general weakness and everything. And after the muscle mass, skeletal mass is reduced, you will have a decreased visceral proteins and followed by impaired immune response, impaired wound healing, and everything, if unattentively left out, by losing the weight progressively, at the end of losing 40% of the weight, you will go straight away into the multi-organ failure and impaired adaptation. And these are the clinical features if you look into that. The apathy, depression, changes in behavior and personality, everything can happen and finally leading them to complete exhaustion. If the patient is normal patient and becoming sick and coming into the ICU, this will develop little longer. But the same patient is catabolic, with the infection or with the surgery and everything, the thing is very fastly happen and it can prepone to the 5 weeks itself. So this is the consequence of malnutrition in a critically ill patient or a hospitalized patient, and this was rightly put out. The question is not whether we should treat malnutrition or not, but how to treat the malnutrition. He is the father of total parenteral nutrition, Erwin Rittler. He rightly put it like nutrition like that. So to date, how do we have nutrition in intensive care units? Carbohydrates means for us is a electrolyte and dextrose containing fluids. Proteins means we always look into the plasma as a protein source, albumin as a protein source and amino acids as a protein source. Vitamins we tend to give more to our hospitalized patient, but we tend to forget the fat. The fat supplementations given to the critically ill patient, we tend to forget. That is the routine practice, conventional practice. But what we should do to avoid this malnutrition in the critically ill patient? Three things we have to do. First thing, we have to understand the basics of nutrition and the word about energy conserve and caloric deficit. And we have to divide all of our ICU patients into two, catabolic patients and non-catabolic patients. And finally, we have to change our practice to combined nutrition. Let us see one by one. So the basics of nutrition, everybody knows. The carbohydrates and fat for the day-to-day energy, it's a current account. To speak, to listen, to eat, to walk, whatever it may be, we need our energy to be supplied by these two things, carbohydrates and fat. But remember, you should not get the proteins for your day-to-day energy expenditure. So that is the basics of nutritional support. So if you want to spare the proteins, the proteins for the bodybuilding, it should never be used for the day-to-day energy expenditure. So to leave or to spare the proteins, you have to adequately supply the carbohydrates and fat to the patients. The energy, day-to-day energy, if it supplies only by the carbohydrate, then that concept is called single energy concept. But the carbohydrate and fat together, if they are supplying the day-to-day energy for us, then it is called dual energy concept. What will happen by putting our patients only with the dextrose and electrolyte solutions in a hospitalized state? It will produce hyperglycemia, and hyperglycemia will impair the immunity. And glucose, the end product is carbon dioxide and water. And more of glucose will lead to more of carbon dioxide, and the carbon dioxide will lead to respiratory stress, increased sympathetic activity, and more water production will end up in having a water retention in our patients. To metabolize carbohydrates, we need phosphate, and it will end up in having a hypophosphatemia, and that will lead to reduced tissue oxygenation. And the carbohydrates, everything will turn into lipids, and the lipids is stored in the fat. The fatty liver, the primary culprit is not the fat what we are eating, but it is the carbohydrates which is the cause for the non-alcoholic fatty liver changes what happening in our patients. And essential fatty acids with a deficit, the patient will end up in having a poor wound healing. Let us see, by combining glucose with the fat emulsions to our patients to supply the day-to-day energy expenditure, the benefits are decreased respiratory stress, improves nitrogen utilization, protein sparing effort, optimal resistance to infection, decreased water retention, and it enables a partial parenteral nutrition to our patient. And remember, it prevents and reverses the fatty liver on our individuals. So the ratio, it may be 50% to 50% in a normal individuals, 60% to 40% in a diabetic patient, and 40% to 60% where the patient having a hypertriglyceridemia. So this should be the ratio. And now it is fat emulsions are freely available in the market. We have a soy oil emulsions, olive oil, fish oil, and put everything together like small lipids. The small lipid contains all the oil together, the soya oil and MCT oil, olive oil and fish oil put together. This is also start available in the market. So coming to the concept, the basic, the caloric deficit you should understand. Let us take this particular case. It's a 50 kilogram individual, and if you calculate the calorie requirement, it comes as 1500 non-protein calories. And if you are supplying 1.5 grams of protein, you should get 300 kilocalories. So finally, the daily requirement of this 50 kilogram individual is 1800 kilocalories per day. He is hospitalized and is undergoing surgery, and we are prescribing him, this is the IV fluid, tend to prescribe. If you go to all the hospitals, 90% of the surgical patients will get this type of IV fluids out there. So this contains dextrose with electrolytes, and it has 150 grams of carbohydrates, nothing else. This 150 grams of carbohydrates will give only 600 kilocalories to the patient. And the deficit is 1800 minus 600, the 1200 kilocalories is every day the patient is having a deficit. And this deficit, it's cumulative. Every day it's cumulative. For the example, 7 days of only IV fluids in a surgical patient, you will have a 1200 into 7, the count will go like anything. But nothing has happened on our patients. Everybody seems to be all right. We are not seeing any biochemical changes also on them. But what really happens, this cumulative caloric deficit is met by our own lean body mass. Our own proteins from the muscles, they started utilizing it and end up in having a loss of lean body mass. So this cumulative caloric deficit are shown in various studies increasing the mortality in a critically ill patients. So critically ill patients can lose as much as 1 kilogram of lean body mass every day if they are highly catabolic, with the infection and everything, organ failure, 1 or 2 organ failures, they will end up in having a 1 kilogram of lean body mass loss. So now we all know we are able to reduce the mortality in intensive care units. The various studies all over the world says that ICU mortality is decreasing over the last 10 years. So we are able to discharge the patient and we are pushing all the critically ill patients into the society. Improved hospital survival, but how many survive even a year after ICU discharge? Exercise limitation and reduced physical quality of life persist even after 5 years of ICU discharge. Why it is happening? More than 40% of the people are not able to cross 12 months after the ICU discharge. Within a year, they die. And 50 to 70% of the people having a cognitive deficit after ICU discharge. And 60 to 80% functional disability. They are not able to have their own activities. Physically, they are in fact. So, are we creating the survivors from the critical illness or we are creating the victims into the society? And this is going to be an epidemic hereafter. Can we end this epidemic of hospital victims? So hereafter, the trials and everything is going to be on improving the quality of life after the ICU discharge. So now itself we are start having various studies coming into the play. How to reduce this type of epidemic in a ICU discharged patients. The conclusion is very clear. If you are able to give a high protein diet to a critically ill patients to the extent of 2 grams per kg per day, the mortality is decreased. And this is 400 patient ICU multicenter trial and showed very clearly high protein diet reduce the lean body loss and the patient will have a good quality if they get discharged from the ICU. So increased protein improves physical function, this is one study. So the caloric deficit, we have to be very careful in a critically ill patient and we have to avoid it. And coming to the division, why we should divide our ICU patients into 2, catabolic patients and non-catabolic patients. If you look into the non-catabolic patient, left starving. So this is a pure physiological starving. And here, the carbohydrate exhaustion happens first. And followed by the fat depletion, last thing to go in a starvation is the protein catabolism. But if the patient underwent the surgery, sepsis, trauma, the first thing, again, the carbohydrate exhaustion, but before the fat depletion, they are having an early protein catabolism. That is what happening in the bariatric individuals. Bariatric people undergoing a surgery, we all tend to think that what is the meaning of giving them the nutritional support? Already they are overweight. By undergoing the surgery, they are able to lose 50 kgs or 10 kgs during the hospitalization. It's going to be benefit for them. No, it is not going to be the benefit. They end up in having a sarcopenia. They are left out with fat, but they have lost all the lean body mass. So that is what happening in the catabolic patients, and we have to be very specific in providing them the nutritional support in a catabolism. So the change should happen in our practice. The change is combined regimen. What do you mean by combined regimen, the nutritional support? So this patient underwent a surgery. The first day is not able to take anything. So everything is provided through the parenteral nutrition. And in the parenteral nutrition, 1800 kilocalories has to be supplied that particular day. Every day they should supply 1800 calories. First day you are not able to take it through the oral route. 100% is the total parenteral nutrition. The second day, some enteral feeds, the due feeds we can start. the surgical patient. If suppose they are started taking the oral diet, and after a week, if they are able to take 1800 kilocalories through the oral route, that is well and good. So during the hospital stay, seen to that the patient is getting the 1800 kilocalories for a 50 kilogram individuals each and every day, because if you leave one day, you cannot catch up on the second day. So every day we have to combine our nutrition and provide them. And finally, this is the conclusion. The calories should be calculated, and that should be provided through the enteral route. The enteral route is the best route. You should not jump into giving the nutritional support to the parenteral route. But the enteral route is not capable of accommodating the caloric need, then you have to go for a parenteral nutrition. In an acute phase of critically ill patient, you used to give them the hypocaloric feed. The carbohydrates and the fat was minimized, only 15 to 20 kilocalories, but we used to give them the high protein, 1.2 to 1.5 grams per kg per day of protein. The same patient becoming all right and started going to the society and started recovering post-ICU discharge, there we have to increase our carbohydrate, fat, and also the proteins. So this is how the nutrition should be addressed, and it should be addressed both by the enteral nutrition and the parenteral nutrition. Why it should be? We have to catch up the nutritional goal within 3 to 4 days of hospitalization or the critical illnesses. What happened in the first 2 or 3 days? You just see this is the total energy expenditure. It can be calculated either by the calorimetry or by the formulas. If suppose the patient's total energy expenditure is 1800 kilocalories and they are sick with the sepsis or the trauma, what happens? The endogenous energy production is stimulated. And this endogenous energy production got F phase in a trauma. By mobilizing all the endogenous sources, they are able to meet the nutritional requirement. At the end of the 3rd or 4th day, if you depend only on the enteral nutrition, you are not able to catch up the total energy expenditure. There we have to supplement with the parenteral nutrition. So the supplementary parenteral nutrition is the key to prevent energy deficits in a critically ill patients. So concluding the surviving malnutrition and critical illness, we all should know the malnutrition in critically ill patient is there. And it's common, but not taken care properly. Critically ill should definitely survive this particular type of malnutrition. Understand the caloric deficit, and it should be avoided at any cost. Don't hesitate to have both enteral and parenteral nutrition to meet the caloric needs of a critically ill patient. Remember the non-catabolic and catabolic deficiencies. Thank you.
Questions, please. No questions. Okay, we'll conclude this.
President, you can give a certificate.